for a lot of you, this will be a very introductory primer on LibreOffice and the community. This is actually a talk, or sort of the basis of a talk that a number of people asked for in the United States and probably elsewhere. Some basic introductory material about LibreOffice, about the community, about freedom source software, and open document format. So this, hopefully this is useful to a number of you. You can take it back to your friends, to your colleagues, to your communities, and also, of course, give you some feedback. We'll be using this for Software Freedom Day in maybe at least three different locations in the United States. Software Freedom Day is September 20th, so please feel free to use LibreOffice. We're more than excited to have people use LibreOffice as their example of what's great about software freedom. So, what is LibreOffice? LibreOffice is a free open source software office suite. And we'll talk a little bit about what free open source software is if you don't know. You can download it, use it, share it, change it. And the Document Foundation, who currently employs me, is the driving force on coordinating development, although there are a number of different organizations and companies that do a lot of the work. It's available for probably the desktop that you use, whether that's a Macintosh or a Windows machine or Linux. And it uses the open document format, which is the premier free and open source, free and open file format for office suites, for office communication. And in addition to ODF, it can import and export tons of file formats, which is very useful. So if you have any questions, please throw something at me. I think that all of you probably don't have that many questions, but you might have some comments. So if you want to know more about using LibreOffice, we have documentation. A lot of people ask, where are the manuals? And so I put it in one of my slides. You can just go to the wiki and get our publications. These are full 100-page or more PDF manuals that you can print out, or you can buy a copy of them, hard copy. And our release notes are considered some of the best out there. They have images, pictures, and screenshots, which it's kind of a novel thing. I don't know if you guys have ever seen release notes when someone releases a version of software. They're often this cryptic text that mentions a bug number and some esoteric thing about fixing a problem. But our release notes have pictures, such as tables work, and there's a pretty picture of a table before and after. Very useful. So I'm guessing probably most of you have used LibreOffice before. Anyone not used LibreOffice before? It's okay. Not judgmental here. Okay. Excellent. That's the useful slide here. That's fine. And some of you probably heard of OpenOffice. In my experience in the United States, there are a number of people that have heard of OpenOffice but not of LibreOffice, which is interesting. Again, that's partially a name recognition component. There are a number of people, too, that maybe used OpenOffice a while ago and maybe still have it on their machine. Yes? Okay.
It's OpenOffice.org or Apache.
Yes. But exactly, that's true, it's technically true, but in the common parlance, people will talk about OpenOffice. In fact, so, yes, this is a question about brand awareness that a lot of us need to work on in terms of people inside the community. But again, this is just a historical component, too, that I find is a useful talking point for talking to people. Because people ask questions about, well, what is LibreOffice, where they come from? So it's fun to talk about history, and I think one neat thing is the fact people often ask, tell me about the Document Foundation, and it's a German nonprofit. Like, why is it a German nonprofit? So, well, that's because historically our development has continued in LibreOffice days, in OpenOffice days, .org days, and in StarOffice days, all from Germany. So, fun historical. So even though people haven't heard about LibreOffice, this is an opportunity, right, to tell people about free software, about LibreOffice, and because people need to do things like deal with spreadsheets and word processing documents, even if they spend their entire day in a command terminal, or a text editor writing code, they still need to deal with invoices, with reports, with presentations. So LibreOffice is useful to you. LibreOffice exists because of our community. I really like to lead in with this when I'm talking to individuals about LibreOffice because a lot of people, I think, see it as a quick resource. They can download, grab, download, use, and they don't understand. understand what it means to be a part of the community. So it's really important to think about how you can contribute back. There are tons of people out there, pretty much in this room, that's working on LibreOffice. So I think it's really important to meeting and talking about the community. So we have a whole bunch of different teams, including people in QA, design, development, etc. I'm probably going to run up against time constraints here, so I'll speed up. We want everyone to contribute to our project. Let's see, so I'm a contributor. There's one of the hats I wear. Here are the actual things that I do. Free and open source software. So how many people here use one of these items? Like maybe you have an Android phone or you use Firefox. So all of these, of course, are free and open source software, which is exciting. Android is mostly free and open source software. An interesting little point to bring up to people about the idea about using software, free source software that's distributable and can be changed and modified and distributed to individuals who don't have experience with free software, free open source software licensing. So indeed, free source software is software that gives you the ability to run software, to copy it, to distribute it. And when talking to people about LibreOffice, I think that using examples is often very good. So the idea that I can give them a copy of LibreOffice on USB stick, that they can, that's a physical copy, but then they can make a digital copy of that and share it with a friend or with 10 friends. That they can talk to someone about the source code. They don't have, you know, an NDA or something about the source code. They can actually discuss that publicly and we actually want them to. That they can change that source code. We want them to change it and give it back to us, but they can keep it if they'd like to. And they can add new features and make improvements. So freedom source software gives users power. And that's really important to the community because by giving users power, by giving them the ability to make changes, they can actually become more involved in the community and then they can make money and do amazing things. So freedom source software, the barriers to sharing software also ties back into the idea of our document formats, open document format, which gives people the ability to share their files with others and to have an equal playing field between different programs that can manipulate Office software, Office formats and data. And again, freedom source software is, I think, a very great mechanism for both development of software, but also for users, because when you have the source code, the ability to identify what's in that source, what's in that the program, and you can reproduce the effects of, say, creating a binary. That's really important for people who might not trust some of the people who might be modifying their source code. So, for example, there are a number of revelations recently about security and privacy going on around the world. So LibreOffice is a tool that, if you want to, you can build it yourself, and you can verify what code is inside there and what code is not inside there. So I will speed through some of these slides about software Libre. So we have Writer. Ordinarily I give a short demo, but I'll speed through. So Writer is our word processing suite. Probably has a very familiar interface for a lot of individuals. We support the import of a lot of common file formats like Microsoft Office's .doc binary format, .docx. And we have a lot of common features that people who have used other suites like Corel Word Perfect or Microsoft Word will be familiar with. Calc has, again, a lot of familiar features. We have a lot of neat new features. We have some 3D graphical new features that we've been adding recently. And we have a number of new tools that we're developing around Calc, some speed ups, some improvements in the way that we do perform complicated calculations so that individuals that are using large data sets can compute data much more efficiently. And Impress is the tool I'm using to do this presentation. This slide seemed very meta, so I thought it would make it even more so. I'll move along quickly. We have a lot of other tools. Again, even in a short 30-minute presentation, there's not enough time. There's some great videos on YouTube that can give you introductions to say how to set up a basic database, how to use our math component for describing various mathematical formula and putting inside, say, a word processing document. And again, a little too much for this short presentation. So the document foundation. Yeah, sorry.
The way it's on the sheet.
Yeah.
To back now.
Yeah.
Looks like there are only videos on YouTube for draw math and base. I would think it's videos.
Okay. Yeah. So there are videos for all kinds of. Yeah. Again, when I did this presentation, my goal was to try to make it, you know, a simple introduction. So I was trying to simplify the language as much as possible. But yes, there are videos available for all kinds of different pieces of LibreOffice on YouTube and elsewhere. And there has been some interest about creating different repositories. I was talking to some of the Media Goblin folks. I don't know if you guys know who Media Goblin is. It's basically I think it's AGPL, FaroGPL, which is a freedom source software license, which too long to talk about right now. But it's a tool available for download that organizations or individuals can run their server, and it can provide a repository for various multimedia images, audio, video. So I think that it could be useful for us to run Media Goblin ourselves for TDF and LibreOffice running, because we could post not just tutorials, we could post all our conference video and other multimedia in a centralized place. So that's, if you're interested, we'd love to have a volunteer help us with that. So very quickly, LibreOffice and the Document Foundation. The Document Foundation is a German nonprofit and has two projects now, one of which is the Document Liberation Project, which seeks to provide a set of libraries that can import and export a large number of document formats. And by large number, I mean maybe we're up to 100, maybe a couple hundred by now. Probably close to 100. So it's a very, very useful tool. Run through TDF membership. We would love for individuals to not only contribute to the project, but become active and continue active over a period of time. So you can have membership inside the Document Foundation organization. And it's a relatively simple process in which you demonstrate that you've been active in the project and working on, say, LibreOffice or Document Liberation for a few months. Demonstrate what you've been doing and indicate your commitment to continue working with the project for several months. 6 months, I believe. It's right there. And I think this is great. I'm not too familiar about other nonprofits that are attached to free software projects, but I think this is a great model because it's a pretty low barrier to entry. It doesn't have a lot of stipulations about you, say, being a programmer. You can contribute in a lot of different ways. But it does provide a framework in which you do have to have a commitment to a relationship with LibreOffice, which we love to have people entering this type of relationship, especially if you're, say, a student or someone else who thinks that working with LibreOffice could be a great way to contribute over the course of maybe a couple of semesters or a summer and semester.
And Rock, can you quickly explain what the voting rights are for members?
Yeah, sure. So Joel is one of our board members, so let's see if I get this right. So board members are given the responsibility, I'd say, to vote in a number of elections, including voting for our board of directors and voting for our membership committee. And is that it? Okay. we also get an awesome hat. Is that Joel's hat?
And a conference location.
So the conference location too. Yes. Do we get a big hat? Is that
I don't think that comes with it. I think it's
next year. So LibreOffice is multi-platform. Again, most of the happy face out of the audience here probably know about different operating systems, but for a lot of people that have a very basic understanding of computing, and I sometimes will ask someone, you know, maybe say, you know, what OS are you using, and they'll say Microsoft Office. So there is a level of understanding that's a little bit difficult. Right now, LibreOffice runs on sort of the most common operating systems, desktop operating systems out there, Windows and OS X and Linux. But we're working on, we have people interested in working on versions for Android and iOS. There are some presentations at this conference about that fact. And we really would like to provide some of the best of breed open document format authoring and editing tools, because our goal is to promote the Document Foundation's primary goals is to promote the use of open document format and other open file formats across a wide range of enterprises inside, say, education and government. And so by providing tools that are excellent at editing ODF and reading ODF, this enables pretty much anyone in the world to create rules, regulations, mandating the use of open file formats with confidence that the tools will exist for them and for their constituents to use them. So open document format is a set of file formats. They're XML-based file formats that were developed in an open standards process and have been ratified by a number of different standards organizations. Currently chosen by a number of countries, including the UK, Belgium, and others as official file formats for document exchange. This is really important because I think it's great to see how different groups and different governments have decided that choosing an open file format is a important step in how they relate information to their citizenry. So ODF has various file formats, including word processing, spreadsheets, presentations, etc. And these are all very similar file formats, and all these can be opened up by LibreOffice. I think that equation is already up. I believe so. I can check on that. I might have copied this off of the wiki, and the wiki might be wrong, but I will check on that.
Yeah, but
I agree there's an inclusion, but I think that actually might be the extension.
Not a good name, at least.
I agree. I think that, yes, that would be complicated, but I mean, is that correct? Okay, we can check if we have internet access. So a little bit of information, again, for a lot of the audiences that I talk to, this is getting a little technical for them, but what I think is neat from my background as being a bit of a technical person is that the open document format is not just the file format specification, it's not really open. The fact is that you can actually open up, in a sense, the file format itself easily. So what it is it's a set of various text-based files, XML files, and it also contains some directories of files that are all compressed using a zip algorithm. And so for pretty much any platform, you can actually open up this file, this binary file, and you can see what's inside it. So you can, for example, look at the images inside your presentation or any other component. And I think that's really great because this gives individuals the opportunity to actually see what's going on inside their file format. Even if they have only a very little technical understanding, I think it's a great place, especially for, say, students, you can say, look, you know, you've created a presentation, or maybe you've created a word processing document, but what does that really mean? And you can very simply give them just a little glimpse into what's going on behind the scenes. And that also gives them power, right? So that gives them the ability to actually see what's inside the document. So they might say, I thought I had an image in the document. Well, if you can open up the sort of guts, the contents of the document, you can see, you know, inside. So this particular ODT, Hello World ODT, doesn't have any, only its thumbnails, doesn't have images inside it. But if I open up, for example, my presentation here, let's see if I might have to pull this over to the side. There we go. Is internal references from one part of the document to refer to particular images. This is just a consistent way of us creating keys to reference from inside the file format to a particular image.
So to warn people today, it's not enough to track in the file, or if you change a file.
Sure, sure. And again, I'm talking in abstracts here. You know, if I were presenting to, say, a group of children, I think this would be a great exercise for them to do with their teacher. And we have a lesson plan, obviously. But again, I just like showing people the inside of a file created by LibreOffice, because I think that it demonstrates the fact that this is really transparent. Now, for comparison, if you guys have ever used, say, AutoCAD, I remember file formats used by AutoCAD. AutoCAD is a computer design program used for modeling all kinds of things, tiny little parts of big buildings. And their file format specification is very complicated and is not well specified. In fact, I'm not sure there's a completely open spec for it. So, whereas the file formats we use inside LibreOffice are pretty much fully specified, and anyone can use them and implement them, AutoCAD is very, very opaque. And so, I think this is just a good demonstration of the comparison between open file formats and closed file formats, which happen to be implemented by programs that are free open source software and closed proprietary software, but that could be the case with any file format. Yeah, go ahead.
Open a doc file.
I should open a doc file? Yes, maybe my... Yeah, next week to do it. I'll do that. I'll try to...
That's just putting the outbox.
Yeah. Okay, let me get my mouse back over here. So, as I'm running over a little bit here, I will try to zoom ahead.
I just checked math and it is ODF.
Is it ODF? Okay, yeah. Yeah, I think I'd seen it before, and yes, that was confusing. But I feel like, yeah, I feel like people are just choosing, you know, third letters, and they said we have 26, and so yeah, we don't have a particular choice. So it just shows. The community. We already talked a little bit about the community and our goals. You can read a lot about these on the LibreOffice website. And again, we're running low on time, so I don't want to jump into these things, but I think this is very important, the fact that what the community believes in terms of providing unfettered access to tools at no cost, and encouraging individuals to translate and document the programming tools into their own native language. So this, I think, is really important, especially because I think that some of these were foundational principles of the LibreOffice community, encourage a number of people to join the community and stay with the community because of the support that we show for them for their local communities. So we have a number of teams. Yes, right there.
I just have one observation. Yeah. It also makes a handy HTML editor. It doesn't write very good code, but it's very handy if you don't have an editor handy for an HTML editor.
Sure, yeah. Personally, I think there might be some other tools that, you know, someone asked, you know, I want to write some HTML code. I think that there are a number of tools out there that we could also try to provide, but if that's the only thing someone has in their system, then they could use LibreOffice to write HTML code. So. As a sort of a side note, we have actually included a couple of neat pieces inside LibreOffice. So LibreOffice ships with a full Python interpreter. Python's a programming language. And so as a result, because if you have this Python interpreter that's bundled with LibreOffice, you could, for example, if you had a locked-out machine that only had LibreOffice installed in some way in your text editor, you could actually tell people to move Python to a class. I haven't found a situation like this, but I've talked to people about this, and we also include a logo interpreter. I don't really have a slide of that, but it's basically a very simplified programming language that can provide the ability to draw using this little turtle, draw graphics, and make the little turtle icon move around the screen. So there are some neat things that are built into LibreOffice already. So, right, we have a number of teams. I just want to go over some of the community teams really quickly. We have a design team that works on user interface and graphical design. I think that Yes, I'm sure that some of these slides might be, various people in the community might have suggestions on how they want to present their team. So please please let me know if you'd like me to say anything. We have a development community. Build LibreOffice, so you can basically take the source code and turn it into binary code and then you can execute on your machine. Start with an easy hack, sort of something very small, simple to, and easy to change. And the development community runs hackfests, so these invitational events where people come together and start using LibreOffice or continue and fix bugs, and usually provide food and other fun things, so people should definitely attend if they're interested. We have a QA team, which I'm partial to because I'm very active in the QA team. We do a whole bunch of different things, figuring out where bugs were introduced into our source code, and testing LibreOffice extensively, and doing other things. We have a language and localization team that tests LibreOffice, works on providing translations of all of our documentation, a whole bunch of our different interfaces and tools inside the project and our website, and also performance testing in QA. So I think the language and localization team is pretty amazing in some ways because they provide a sort of duplicate of a lot of the different environments that other teams provide, such as QA and help, I think, with development, for example. We have a team for website infrastructure, so if someone has experience maybe being a sysadmin or writing HTML code or working on new tools, we would love to have someone join us and work on both existing technology and promoting new tools. So for example, we have some people working right now on single sign-on, which would make it much easier for volunteers and other people to use our services, report bugs, get feedback, join our mailing list, etc. So we'd love to have someone working, helping us work on single sign-on. Documentation team writes tons of documentation we use, prepares all of that, bundles it into PDFs, works on providing printed copies of those available online, for purchase online, and also works on creating a whole host of other material, tutorials, and training materials as well. Marketing outreach does, perhaps what you'd expect, consistent messaging is really important for LibreOffice. Coordinates with teachers and educators, and I do a bit of work with outreach in the United States, and so we both attend existing events, conferences, etc., and we run our own events. So for example, this October I'm going to be running one, a QA-based event in Seattle, Washington, in the US. So, benefits to the community. I think I've talked about a number of things. Joining the community can be really valuable. Yes, sir.
Don't you have a support team?
A what?
A team providing support on the user list as support.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we do. We have a defined support team. I don't know.
But it's really useful to do it.
Yeah.
Because if you on the user list,
support, but I'm not sure there's a unifying component to that team, but I agree that some type of unified team. Whether that, you know, they don't meet monthly or anything, but that they can link those people together, because we don't have that the community right now. So several reasons to join the community. I mean, gain experience, look good at your resume, people might hire you. And I was recently hired by the Dr. Foundation to work on QA, so there are, I know a number of people, when I was recently, last year, hiring individuals to work on a project, their credentials from working on various free software projects was really critical. We were also developing free software, but it was really important to see what they had done and the code they contributed. And of course, the community is fun. We like to have a lot of fun in the QA team. A lot of our teams enjoy their correspondence and their work. And I think that, you know, teaching people about free and open source software, telling people about what they can, amazing things they can do with LibreOffice is empowering and rewarding. And so I think there's a lot of benefit you can have from joining the community itself. So we're running low on time. I'm going to avoid a little demo I had. And let's see if I have anything else for you. I think that's all that I have. So, here's my end. There we go. Here's my end slide. If you have questions, comments, concerns, think that I should add something about the support team, please let me know, and please email me. So, any questions? Input?
Mentioning the headphones.
What? Sure.
And maybe that, and also then the ask site, so people know where to ask their questions.
Sure.
Just for one slide documentation.
So maybe a slide or two about support would be good. That would include both. So support for maybe, you know, how you can help yourself, and then support, like, to ask for help. Yeah, that would be a good goal.
I think one thing, Wayne, you were talking about how it's good to be able to see the spec. I know I've gotten questions from people saying, well, like, if malicious people are able to see the code, can't they
Purge
you faster?
Yeah.
And so I think it's good to say that that's, in fact, the exact opposite. It's kind of counterintuitive that you see the code, and that makes it much harder to do malicious things.
Yeah, sure. So explain that a lot of people can look at it.
Should I try to explain sort of
just, why? I think very briefly, I think especially with our quality control, the way that we have review of patches and stuff, that it's very, very hard for, and if something, I mean, outside of our organization, even for other open source projects, because there's so many people looking at the code, if something did get in, it would be caught very quickly most of the time, versus closed source settings. I mean, this is possible. So.
Right, and I mentioned sort of briefly about this idea of a black box.
Again,
I wasn't sure, and again, I sort of made this presentation for an audience that would often be a lot less technical than you guys are, I think. And so, again, it's tricky because trying to know your audience and what level of technical, you know, I might be a little reticent to bring up the idea of, to say, like, well, you know, LibreOffice is, I might say LibreOffice is, secure in certain ways, but to bring up this issue of, say, like, to bring the question myself of, oh, like, there could be a problem with software, it seems like sort of confusing matter, especially if people are, have a basic understanding of software, if that makes sense. So, but I think it's one, sorry.
Yeah, I had a question. Do you have some tips for, because you were mentioning that you were talking about free open source software, and I've noticed that when I'm engaging with people who may not really know about this, the first question is that I don't really understand how that works. I mean, how can it be better? Just tell me. And it's not that they're biased, in fact, do you spend time with them talking about this, or?
Yeah, no, I mean that's definitely, I mean, so talking about free and open source software is, you know, set of talks in and of itself, right? And so Yeah, I mean, that is one of the challenging things. As I mentioned, there are a couple of slides here I didn't want to gloss over, but I was trying to, what does the LibreOffice community mean? It's like, these things, you know. But so they were all really important ones, right? And the same thing with this idea of licensing, and licensing as a means to an end, to provide people with rights and abilities with the source code of the project. So I do try to spend a certain amount of time with people. I think that you know, with some people, I might bring up the topic and I'd say, LibreOffice is provided under a freedom of source software license, and so it gives you these abilities, like, you can take this program home and share it with your friends, or you can run the same program at home at school. So I think I often try to present to people as like benefits it confers, but again, I agree there's a large number of things, like there's a whole ecosystem and mentality environment that is created by having a license that provides certain rights and guarantees. I mean, of course, then we can get into things like permissive licensing versus copyleft licensing, which is exciting. I mean, questions about why is LibreOffice copyleft? That sort of goes down a certain rabbit hole, which is fun to go down. It's fun to grab, a person or five and be like, let's grab coffee and talk for, half an hour or two. it's difficult in my mind, because I think some of these topics are important, to try to summarize them accurately without misleading somebody or not giving them enough information. Is that sort of what you're asking about?
Yeah, it's because basically sometimes...
How do you make a soundbite?
No, because basically sometimes I'm like, am I handling this right in the sense that I'm going to spend so much time talking about these matters, and then at the end of the day, we're still having someone in front of us who wanted to know about this office.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's like some sort of certainty to this person, basically converting someone. But most of the times they're very interesting, but it's like they just watched on TV a very interesting documentary that they got hooked up with for some reason. About the life of the white whales under the North Pole at midnight. But they were like, it was a set of very beautiful images, but how does that help?
So do I need narration client?
Yeah, I mean, and it's I was
wrong
because he thinks that. Exactly.
Yeah.
So this is why I was asking that question, is do you actually feel you get bogged down to?
Yeah.
Or as a general rule, it's like, okay, it just went really well and people go there.
Yeah, it's tough to tell. Again, I feel like I am surprised by sometimes different individuals. We have biases, and we see someone or someone starts talking to us, and we see someone. And so I'm at a conference and I see someone in like a DEF CON t-shirt or something. So I have a certain assumption about their technical understanding. Or I see someone who looks, has very professional business wear on, and is carrying like a leather case or something like that. And then they might be like, hi, I'm a dating hacker, like I do this, that, the next thing, And I'm just like, I did not expect you to be dressed that way. And I think it's difficult sometimes to read, even when you're talking to somebody, until you've been talking for a while, how much they're understanding or what their level of comprehension is or their interest. So I think that what I often try to do is to provide a basic level of information about a topic and try to gauge someone's reaction can be tough. It's very tough.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a really relevant topic of discussion for us and for other people and other free software projects, because messaging is this huge deal, and it is, I think, important for us to figure out how we can be effective without being pedantic or without being... I mean, there are a number of times that I'll try to talk to someone at a conference and they'll sort of stop me and they'll say, but can I use this on my computer? And like, they don't... Like, their comprehension of what software is limited. And so sometimes, especially in a mixed room where you can't go around and ask each person, what's your experience? Are you a programmer? Have you been working with software for a decade? Or do you really you have an iPad and you know that you can maybe go to a website on there.
Yeah.
You know, and so trying something like licensing, like a free and open software, to try to explain what that means to someone is tough. In a group setting. Yeah,
so just one other suggestion, because I don't think you talked about how to use the parallel install language.
Yeah.
But I think that's important to say, like, you know, you want both. And for us to succeed, I think that's going to be the first step for a lot of people is understanding, like, just because you install LibreOffice doesn't mean you're replacing Microsoft Office. And
it's on LibreOffice and parallels, but not two parallels.
Yeah, not two parallel installs.
I was like, Joel, I like QA and all.
But just because a lot of people, I think, because the costs of Microsoft Office are so hidden because they're bundled with computers. A lot of times, a lot of people are like, it came with my computer, so they just assume maybe it's free or something. But I think it's good to say, like, just up front, you know, you can install our stuff, and it's not going to screw up your current setup, so.
Sure, and one way that I've introduced people to LibreOffice has been in its use as sort of a Swiss Army knife tool. So, for example, I know that some people have said, like, oh, I got this document, you know, I got this like Microsoft Works document or something. And so at least in the past, you couldn't open Microsoft Works documents in Microsoft Office. And so I'd say, oh, just grab my LibreOffice, like that, and open it. And then, you know, sort of start them with a little tidbit. Or tell them, hey, if you have a bunch of documents that you want to turn to PDFs, like I can show you how to do that on the command line. So you can do them all at once. And then if they're interested, you know, I can say, oh, and by the way, like, you can do some other stuff with this tool. So, like, little tidbits.